put off by how long this video is. Don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. I either have or will cover other parts of this franchise, and this video either is or will be linked below. I'm not going to restate here what I did or will say in the other video. These videos get long enough as it is. Please note that though this is a spoiler-free review of the subject, I do spoil the series and or franchise leading up to this particular entry. Logan Murray. Starting with the plot. The year is 2029, so 6 years after the now prevented dystopian future seen in Days of Future Past. Mutants have been dying off due to, actually I'm not sure I should say exactly why, and yeah, that's not that different from, you know, the Days of Future Past, and yeah, it's kind of a lower budget version of that, and Apocalypse was dystopian too. Is the series stuck? Xavier and Logan are together, and Xavier, not as a couple, not that there would be anything wrong with that, but yeah, Logan is taking care of Xavier, and Xavier finds a kid that he asks Logan to take care of. And I suppose I shouldn't say exactly, I won't just yet at least say exactly who Laura is. Now, basically the reason that Xavier knows that she even exists, you know, that it's some combination, you know, which we could more or less guess from trailers and such, some combination of him, you know, realizing it by his telepathic ability and her literally sniffing out. Yeah. And, you know, yeah, the last film with Jackman's Wolverine has him in much the same situation as the first film. Xavier is trying to talk him into helping other mutants, and more to the point, a troubled, in part by her powers, which she can't cope with, scared teen tween girl who either talks too much or very little with no one else to help, needs him to drive her to safety. So, what kind of name is X-23? And she can take over for him just as she has in the comic. She can join the X-Force in their film, which is coming up. We already do have Psylocke, although I still hope they recast her. And if it's set somewhat in the future, which it might be, so that it's not they're not stuck with a really young X-23, although of course that could also be interesting. But yeah, you know, Cable is coming up, Deadpool will supposedly be in it as well, and maybe she'll wear the yellow and blue spandex she does in the comic these days. And it does seem like at least a bunch of the other members of the team will wear what they do in the comic. Thanks, MCU. I am going to dive headfirst into my notes. That I took during the movie. The movie is 2 hours and 11 minutes, not counting the end credits. I did not sit through the end credits because I heard that they don't, that there's no post-credit scene. The movie starts with, you know, much like The Wolverine, the movie. This opens with basically Logan getting involved with some nobodies, some jerks that, yeah, although in this case, it's that they're trying to steal the car that he basically works as a driver near the border to Mexico, and they're trying to steal this car. And yeah, you know, at first they, you know, he doesn't make a big deal out of it. He's just like, stop doing that, you're doing damage to the car and it's going to scare away customers. And at first they don't even realize he's there, and then when they do, they just shoot him in the chest and figure, now we can steal the car. And he like gets up and says, I told you not to do that. And he like, he does fight them, but he's kind of like drunk, and you know, he barely cares. So it's this kind of start-stoppy, slightly awkward. It's really funny, actually. And yeah, they'll like try to hit him and damage the car instead, and he'll, you know, yell at them for that. Yeah. It really sets the tone very well. And actually, in some of the early scenes of just Logan doing the driving, you know, it actually made me think of like Taxi Driver, though it doesn't go that far, but yeah, you know. And when we first meet Boyd, he's actually really charming, and he approaches Wolverine, yeah, very, very early on, and tries to get him to work with them. Now, the adamantium bullet is brought up from the end of Origins, and you know, I figured that, you know, it's kind of like the reverse of the fact that you have the bullet reminds us of that movie, and I don't think that was a particularly good idea, but they do interesting things with it here. The people he drives are often really shallow, and like young people partying and such. And yeah, it's so obvious that you're gonna know it even if I don't tell you. So I'm not gonna give away the details. But yeah, like Origins, very early on, Wolverine is basically tricked into thinking that someone is dead, someone that he cares about. Yeah, you know, X-23 has some of the DNA that Logan has. I'm going to get more into that. But when the Reavers try to capture her, Boyd, you know, they're like shooting at her, and Boyd is like, stop shooting. She heals. You know, it's not stop trying to kill the 12-year-old. It's just you're wasting your bullets. And there's this, you see in the trailers, that there's this scene by like a warehouse, this action scene, and it's actually, it's X-23, and she does kind of the thing that we've wanted to see Logan do. She basically clears out these guys, taking them out one at a time, not being seen by them and such. There's a torture scene that was really unnecessary. I suppose it could have just been an interrogation scene. And there's this company called Transigen, and at one point they talk about, you know, it's intransigent, so it's intransigent. I don't know if this really is a thing. It might be just, maybe I'm reading into it, but it seems like they're, you know, these Marvel movies are trying to show the DCEU that you can do some of these things without ruining things by doing these things. At more than one point in this movie, the plot stops so that, you know, major characters can sit still and watch videos on cell phone that give backstory, and it really works. It's compelling, and it doesn't, yeah. You know, the in some ways, Laura is basically your typical teen girl. You know, she can be a little difficult to be around. You get the sense that this is the first time she's been in an elevator. They go into this hotel, and Logan presses the button for the floor that they're going to be on. And she, like, you know, press a thing, and it makes a sound, and glows, okay, I'll do that. And she starts pressing buttons for other floors, and he's like, no, don't do that. And, you know, the moment he lets go of her hand, she goes back and tries to push one of the buttons. Like some of the other movies, this has Xavier freeze people. And this time it's like, you know, what if he had less control over his powers? And what would it look like if someone tried to fight against it? At one point, one of the villains says, you know, I had to come in and bring new tools to bear. I think he's putting too much faith in the ability to use tools in the common bear. There's this scene where Laura is like eating dinner with other people, and it's probably the first time she's really seen like a fork, and she has terrible table manners, and yeah. And Xavier and Wolverine kind of snark and snap at each other about the school for the gifted, where basically, yeah, I'm going to go ahead and quote some of it. Basically, they're talking about, it's because there's this other character who's talking about like leaving school, and Charles is like, I want to hear more about what exactly are you thinking with this? And Logan is like, yes, be careful, because he ran a school for a while. A school for a special needs. And Charles is like, that's an interesting way to put it. You were actually a student of there for a while. I wish I could say you were a really good student. And Logan is like, yeah, I flunked out a couple of times. And it's a really cute riffing on the relationship the two have had over the course of the films. There's this anti-corporation message, which, I mean, I approve, but I do feel like it's, I don't know, I certainly don't like everything they do with it. There's this point where character brings out like a gun and he assures someone, no, don't worry, we're not gonna need it, which I'm pretty sure is why he has it. There are these references to that something went wrong, that Charles lost control of his powers. There's a character named Will Munson, and I would bet that that's like a reference to Unforgiven, with Bill Money. Bill Money Credit Checks would be the full name. Wolverine seems less inclined to start strange cars with his claws anymore. There's this sign that says refuse to something roadkill. I would have guessed it would say eat, but instead it was be. The pacing, some have said it's like a slow burn. That's a good way to put it. It can feel a little start-stoppy, and it's definitely not a really fast-paced. Like, I like this better than Deadpool, but I mean, if I was gonna rewatch a Wolverine solo movie for action scenes and such, it would be The Wolverine, it would not be this. And if you don't care that much about the characters, if you don't care that much about Logan, Xavier, and/or X-23, don't go into this just like I want to see, a lot of action or such. There's a decent amount of action, but it's really not the same amount as in the recent films. And considering, other X-Men films don't necessarily have as much action as other action movies might, but that's because they have all these characters who have complex powers, and you have to think of different ways for them to use them. A movie with Logan, it doesn't have to be that complicated, and there's not that much. And some action scenes I felt like ended where they easily could have gone on, where they would have gone on for longer in other movies. But yeah, I don't think there's too little action. Or that too long ever really passes without something happening. In The Wolverine, there's a lot of Logan waking up. In this, there's a lot of like going to sleep or needing sleep, needing rest for both him and Xavier and X-23 and others. you know, usually Wolverine says, I'm the best at what I do, but what I do isn't very nice. In this, he says, I suck at this instead, so, yeah. There are entire chunks of the movie that don't really have action. I might have already said that. No action scene is like pointless or doesn't alter the status quo. And I also really appreciate the bad guys who have guns. Don't forget that they have guns for like the whole movie, just because the guy they're fighting doesn't have guns. There's this really stupid and ugly message that I'll get into detail in the spoiler section. There's this bit where, like, Logan starts to say, go, go, and he just keeps saying go. Eventually he says run, but yeah, he says go, like, a dozen times. When the credits started, when the man comes around starts playing, which, yeah, I approve. Now, on plot, I did mean to watch this basically at the actual premiere, or at least very, very close to it, but it got to be about a week later, today, basically because I, you know, when I was planning when I was going to review what, I planned Bioshock Infinite for, you know, a week ago for the premiere, because I'd forgotten when Logan came out. Now, this was supposed to be released in 3D here, but right before the premiere, like 28th of February, they removed those from the theater website. Before I ordered my tickets. They have at least once changed it after I ordered my tickets, and I just got a phone call saying, you know, the 3D showing is gone. Now, you know, I want to say so long to Jackman's excellent Wolverine. Thanks for the memories. You can go into this movie not knowing anything about the other movies. If, like, you were unthawed yesterday and you're like, I want to go to see a movie. Yeah, you don't need any prior knowledge of anything that has to, like, if you know that a mutant means an individual that has genes that are different from the rest of the group, that's all you need to know. And the language of English. Now, as we see in the trailer at a convenience store, Laura grabs some tasty, crunchy product placement and washes it down with some smooth, refreshing product placement. And yeah, in the trailer, Wolverine finds the comics and, you know, says, "We got ourselves an X-Men fan." No, it's not that Deadpool's meta is contagious. I love it with that character, but, you know, keep it out of a film like this. No, in the film timeline, their heroics have inspired comic books, and that's what we were seeing. Now, we finally get an R-rated Wolverine film, and it does deliver on at least almost everything that we would want from such. Now, here in my city, you can bring infants to some screenings of this film at 10 a.m. It's alright, they leave the lights on. Sometimes we Scandinavians do go too far in the direction of, yeah, sure, why limit it? Anyway, Mangold has directed 10 films, including this one, and 5 of them have been R ratings, rather than PG-13, which the other 5. So it's not the first time he directs an R. You know, some directors really cannot make the jump in either direction comfortably. And the other R-rated movies he's directed are Heavy, Copland, Girl Interrupted, Identity, and 310 to Yuma. I watched Identity years back, not really a fan, but I will say that is a movie that, you know, doesn't feel like a PG-13 that just happened to be changed, or, yeah. Or an R-rated movie directed by a PG-13 director. Right from the first trailer, you know, this looked like it would, as, you know, all indications pointed to that it was, and indeed it is, the best of the film franchise by far, the deepest of them. And this is the same director as The Wolverine, but it is a very different film from it. You know, it has to do with studio pressure and who wrote the script and such. And, you know, Jackman actually accepted a pay cut, you know, doing it for half the money to make sure that the movie was interesting, and, you know, basically told the director, "I'll drive myself to the ends of the earth to make it the best one." And the director also called it an intimate film. And he said, "I don't want to participate in the superhero movie arms race. I wanted to focus on the one film." And he also said, "The only reason to make a film is to have people feel something from it." Moving on to plot analysis. Now, apparently, basically, you know, coming up with the idea for this, you know, Hugh Jackman was hungover. You know, he was done doing press for Chappie, and the director of that, Neil Blomkamp, asked what was next for Wolverine, and Hugh didn't have an idea at the time, but then after having a few glasses of wine, he fell asleep and woke up 4 in the morning, grabbed a recorder, and summed up what Wolverine 3 would, you know, be a mix of Unforgiven, The Wrestler, and Shane. And, yeah, these three movies would be the basis of the storyline, idea, theme behind the next and last Wolverine film. I have not watched Shane, but I would like to. And I did rewatch both Unforgiven, which I may have to do a video on, and The Wrestler. Because this trilogy proves that once you go Aronofsky, you never go back. But yeah, I rewatched those in preparation for this review. And it's only my second viewing of The Wrestler, and I may have to do more videos on that. And, you know, a major difference between this film and those two is that in this, the action is quote-unquote fun. You know, Unforgiven, it's ugly, nasty, messy, leads to more violence, it attracts bad people, and turns good people bad. It takes people forever to die, it hurts, it ain't the same as shooting birds. Deserves got nothing to do with it. Yes, there are scenes similar to Western Spaghetti and otherwise, but the context is very different. There's no glory to it. It haunts you. It takes a lot of booze to get there, to get back out of there, to deal with it. You know, Voyager Suitor is another example. And, you know, it's been too long for me to be certain, but I do recall A History of Violence as an example of violence working, or at least, you know, it being satisfying. On, you know, problems that come up when you didn't invite them or agree to them. But in there, it's also ugly and nasty. And, you know, Roger Ebert said of that movie that, you know, History of Violence could refer to, you know, a suspect with long history of violence, the historical use of violence as a means of settling disputes, and the innate violence of Darwinian evolution, in which better adapted organisms replace those less able to cope. I am a complete Darwinian, says Cronenberg, whose new film is in many ways about the survival of the fittest at all costs. And, yeah, also said of it, it showed how we secretly crave what we publicly condemn. I'm kidding, I did rewatch that. Any excuse to rewatch Cronenberg. And Daphne Keene is marginally better than the girl in that. It's a close call. And, you know, that movie does have X-Men 1's Kitty Pryde in it for another link. You know, I realized, you know, or re-remembered rather, you know, people were like, oh, X-Men Apocalypse, we finally get Jubilee. She doesn't use her powers in that movie. She also doesn't use her powers in the first two X-Men movies. She did in X2 in a deleted scene, but yeah, some people forget she is in the first two X-Men movies, and I forget she might be in X3 as well, and even played by the same girl as in X2, but yeah, in X2, I think they even say her name. Storm says her name at one point, but yeah. Addressing her. And, you know, that movie was the first time I really noticed William Hurt in something, so seeing with General Ross in The Incredible Hulk was a huge surprise. Excuse me. Now, violence is a necessary evil in this as well, but we are meant to enjoy it, and it does solve some problems, not only cause them. And this film has also been compared to The Dark Knight, so I also rewatched that. Now, this does also have some well-choreographed action scenes, but they do not reach the level of that movie's action as, like, an overall, yeah, but, you know, the action scene that just builds and builds rather than kind of starts and stops or such is kind of a lost art today. You know, Christopher Nolan can do them, Joss Whedon can do them, James Cameron can do them, and evidently James Mangold can do them. you know, Steve Shires points out two or three set pieces would, you know, that George Miller could be proud of are in this movie. You know, and they'll work together in the fights, accomplishing things they couldn't each do individually, but they can as an ensemble. And, you know, one person online at least said, you know, there's been post-credit scenes in all of these. In the whole series, he made it sound like, basically, there weren't in X-Men 1 and 2, and I think I read that First Class didn't either, but other than those, yeah, they have been. Plot details. I rewatched the original trilogy of X-Men films and their DVD special features. Those are the ones I own from out of the series. And I've watched every X-Men film, every film in the continuity, and except for Deadpool, I've watched them all twice. And I will rewatch Deadpool probably when I, you know, rewatch it to watch and review the sequel. I haven't read Old Man Logan or any current X-Men since around the, you know, around 2000. And this does have a lot in common with some of my favorite stories. I forget what they're called, and I never knew their original American names anyway, since they're written, you know, written in my own language. But the, you know, the one with Volk, the Russian, you know, the Russian word for wolf. And that one where there's the guy who he worked with decades back, and like it's like he's come back or something, and yeah. And maybe killing people that Logan cares about, such. And yeah, the only thing that I didn't love, you know, not like, but love about the trailers is the family gathering for dinner. It looked like it might be a little cheesy. It really wasn't. And, you know, I did also worry that the grim darkness of it might get to be excessive or play too heavily. You know, and also a lot of humor without becoming too light. I don't think it particularly falls into those traps, but I do understand why some people might think it does go too far in the darkness. If you start to watch, like if you rent this or something, and you start to watch it and you feel like the first half hour is just the most depressing thing you've seen in a long time, it does get more uplifting after that. I guess when the... once they leave... once they get in the car and start to leave where they have been for a while, then things start to get less dark and such. And the... yeah, I suppose that's... yeah. And it doesn't really come up, but I am glad that this doesn't really perpetuate the stupid idea that Wolverine is afraid of flying in these, yeah, in this, in the film continuity. And this is easily the best of the solo Wolverine trilogy, and I do still love the Wolverine, but, you know, Origins, yeah. And this doesn't particularly have, like, comic book costumes. Now, the movie is basically a road movie. Moving on to main characters. Now, Hugh Jackman said, you know, he's not doing it for the heck of it. It's the real Wolverines the fans wanted to see. And both Wolverine and Xavier are older and are having, you know, they're losing control of their powers, they're in pain, they're lonely, feeling like they've failed. You know, Logan is having problems with his knuckles getting an erection anymore. People now bleed when he cuts them, which is really confusing. He's having trouble remembering what's canon, what isn't, not only in the movies either. Oh, we all are, but still. And Xavier is grumpier and more foul-mouthed than before, but still has some hope. And, you know, it's somewhat like Safe House. Yeah, the 98 version, not 2012 or 2015. And apparently he is very joking in real life as well. Now, this is the first of the solo movies where Stewart plays a big credited role as Xavier. And Wolverine is at his most interesting, or at least his most broody, when he's forced to confront all the pain that he often regrets later inflicts on other people. In particular, right after the Weapon X program, where he was really animalistic and just barely directed his rage at the right people. And in this, he's even withdrawn, probably in part due to stuff like that, and they keep pulling him back in. Because this girl wouldn't exist in her current form if not for his DNA. She is where he was, he has to admit, non-verbally, that he used to be, as out of control as she is, and no one will ever understand her like he can. And they are genetically related. This is in addition to the drive he already feels to protect those that need it, especially young women, especially ones that he has a close relation to, such as with his romantic partners and X1 Rogue, since he helps drive her. And this is all very relatable to young cis straight males, since it's just a roided up version of what we do feel we've done or are doing in our teenage years. Now, X-23 doesn't say a lot. She's very emotional, but keeps it hidden. She's very damaged with emotional baggage, temperamental, having troubles relating to other people. But unlike the typical teen, note I did not say typical teen girl, she has an adamantium skeleton and claws, including in her feet, and a healing factor. And these do make the cutting a lot easier to both to do and hide. Okay, I'm kidding about that last part. She does not cut herself. She leaves that to Logan. He does have more experience, after all. And, you know, it's been said of her that she has a feral intensity, and she's not annoying. She doesn't talk very much, and she's an 11-year-old girl equipped with all the volatility, instability, mood swings, shadows, and potential violence of our hero. You know, she's intimidating, creepy, but at times a sweet preteen girl. And moving on to supporting characters. I have suspended the in midair with my mutant abilities of a whiteboard and some fridge magnets, refrigerator magnets, the smartphone, and I am trying to make sure I can actually read my notes now that the smartphone is further away from me. Now, it makes a ton of sense to bring the Reavers into it, and I knew the moment that I saw them in the trailer that these were the Reavers. You know, I read X-Men in the 90s and distinctly remember them, and we already knew that Mr. Sinister would appear in one of these soon and that it would be related to Wolverine. You know, the Reavers are basically this team of, you know, in the comics, they're basically all cyborgs. Here, you know, some of them are, but, you know, yeah, it seems like they also do have human ones. There's this part where one of them fixes his, you know, prosthetic metal hand, and it's right out of the original Terminator where he does that. And, yeah, they in the comics, they're dedicated to the destruction of the X-Men, particularly Wolverine, you know, getting revenge on him. And, you know, in the comics, Lady Deathstrike was one where, you know, in these movies, she is a mutant, not a cyborg. You know, cyborg in one of these wouldn't really have flown back in 03, but now you can. And, you know, Caliban is played by the guy who plays Wheatley in Portal 2. That's quite fun. And he does do some of that same shtick. Now, Richard E. Grant plays Xander Rice, the surgical head of the Project Transigen. And, you know, Film Brain notes that he takes he kind of takes over for Holbrook as the main villain. It feels like he's out of a different film, especially with the conspiracy thing. And yeah, and Boyd Holbrook plays Donald Pierce, the chief of security for Transigen. And you know, apparently Deadpool, you know, there's this teaser trailer which everyone who's wanted to see has already seen online. Yeah, has also seen online, you know, that was to play before the movie starts, and I worried that would wreck the tone. Fear not, it didn't play in front of my screening at all. It's a really fun teaser, but it would not work in front of this at all. You know, that's a post-credit scene, yeah. Action and violence. Please don't say, oh, but it's R-rated. Yes, it is. And you knew that going in if you paid any attention at all. You know, it's really not gratuitous. There's one exception to that. There's so many blades going to this one spot, and just, you know, this guy's face is completely unrecognizable, and it's played for laughs. Of course, referring to the impromptu cutting of Logan's beard. And I suppose that's going to be it for that one. Critics. Now, some say that, you know, this whole thing of no more mutants, that it's not explained enough. I feel like there's room for doing that in following movies. You know, this user says, you know, what, the X-Men didn't try to stop it? They didn't have any ideas? All this shows is that they failed. You could have a movie saying, you know, set after this one, saying, you know, kind of going into why they failed. You could do a prequel to this where you show some of the attempts. You know, you can do prequels and show stuff that we already know how it's going to work out. And it can still be compelling. Now. I suppose that is more or less going to be that. Yes. Please note that this video contains spoilers for the subject and the series and/or franchise leading up to this entry. Logan movie thoughts, starting with plot. That went exactly as I'd hoped it would. The last lines spoken in the movie are apparently the same as in the movie Shane, and you know, pretty much. And I do think that that worked pretty decently. And, you know, the lines, so this is what it feels like, you know. He's seen death, caused death so many times, but this is the first time he's tried dying, which I say the first time because this is comic books and nobody stays dead except for Uncle Ben. And, you know, X-23 kills X-24. You know, is that the Electra Complex thing? You know, and Wolverine talks about, you know, he wants to kill himself, and then by killing X-24, yeah, and, you know, is also, he kind of looks like Liv Schreiber in Origins, and that is slightly cool. I do feel like they could have just had it be that character, you know, bring in Liv Schreiber and say, you know, oh, this is a, you know, a clone of Schreiber, but yeah. And, you know, some people have said, oh, how are they gonna continue this film series? New X-Men with the kids? I feel like that's pretty, yeah. I mean, you could do a follow-up to this movie that starts right where this one left off. We don't know what they find, you know, once they reach their destination. And I figured that this would be like the Wolverine. Very few powered characters. There are a lot, they just don't have a lot of screen time. And the, you know, Hipster Dave of Cinema Snob website said that, you know, there might as well have been just two or three of them. Yeah, I kind of agree. And I do appreciate that X-24 and Wolverine fought more than once, and that it didn't just feel like it was the same exact fight. I really hate that this that this actually said GMOs are used to kill off minorities. You know, literally with the mutants who have always been, you know, a you know, allegory for real life minorities, and then you actually have, you know, oh, they're shutting off our water, they're making it impossible for us to make a living and such. You know, and they immediately try to hire Logan as muscle for them, and just, yeah. I kind of liked, you know, it seems a little something that Wolverine is just ready to let X-23 go, but yeah, the scene of him chasing, you know, going into the woods to help defend them, you know, forgetting the stupid Deus Ex Machina, you know, liquid courage. But I also wasn't a huge fan of how X-23 seemed to almost refer to just every of the mutant kids in general. Yeah. And, you know, the whole immigrant thing was pretty clearly, you know, commentary. And I like the thing with, you know, you're going to have to live with hurting, yeah, having hurt people. And, you know, she says, you know, oh, bad people. I only hurt bad people. And he says, saying, you know, it doesn't make a difference, basically. And, yeah, that is how it is, you know, when you... I don't know from personal experience, but you know, when you look at, you know, it's what they say, people who have done a lot of, you know, killing or maiming or just, you know, or lesser violence, yeah, they're haunted by it, they feel bad about it. And you also, you know, I had nightmares, people were hurting me, I have nightmares too, I'm the one hurting people, and yeah. Which is also a good follow-up to the whole Jean Grey thing, Wolverine, those haunting nightmares, yeah. You know, I did think it was kind of funny when, you know, the once she did start talking, she, you know, spoke a lot of different English, and, you know, she said, I'll drive, and, you know, yeah, that's, they immediately think that they can just drive perfectly, yeah. And, you know, she hits him, and it's, don't hit me, and, yeah. And I don't know if, when she said, you know, when he said, you can talk, then what was that whole mute act? I half expected her to actually say, you know, as it's a, you said that you didn't speak English, and no, you assumed. I mean, yeah, it seems like a Rush Hour Britt Ratner reference, you know, since he directed X3. And then right after she does start talking, he wants her to shut up. And, yeah. And, you know, just like Will said about Nate. You know, and someone pointed out, it's not really explained why she didn't talk before then, and then she's just talking. Yeah. When Caliban, you know, grabs the grenades and bombs himself to destroy the truck and try to get as many of the enemies as he can, that was very, excuse me, Universal Soldier. And then you also have X-23, you know, stabbing, yeah, very Universal Soldier, which I suppose makes sense. And seeing X-24, you know, when they're face-to-face and such, Wolverine and X-24, that really reminded me of, like, Agent 48 from, you know, Hitman games. And that might be more or less the notes I had. The thing with, you know, no, Eden isn't a real place. Look, it's just from this comic book. you know, I did think that was a decent idea that, you know, no, it is real, but, you know, it might be, we don't know. But they put it in this magazine so that those who needed to find Eden would be able to. I really appreciate in the horses on the freeway scene that they didn't actually start butchering these animals graphically, you know, like just gorily having them run over, you know, which, yeah, I'm glad nothing was gratuitous, but I do think that the torture, no, none of the violence was gratuitous, but I do think the torture scene was unnecessary, and yeah. And I did think that it worked decently with the train stopping the chase, although it is, of course, real cliche. And that might be everything for, you know, paper notes. Okay, that brings us to characters. If I can grab the pen. Now, apparently in the commentary to X-Men Apocalypse, I did actually listen to it, but I might have missed that, but, yeah. You know, because the library had the DVD, otherwise I would have only watched it in theaters, but, yeah, you know, the on-screen debut of Mr. Sinister would be, you know, yeah, the post-credit scene from Apocalypse, but the, you know, James Mangold decided that the character would not appear in the film because just the, it wouldn't fit the grounded style, and I definitely agree with that. I talked about that in the Apocalypse video. I wasn't sure how that was gonna gel with the rest of, yeah. Although, I mean, if he had appeared in the post-credit scene in this movie that had Apocalypse, okay. But, you know, the name, the appearance, you know, better to save him for a later film. And there is still room. You know, you have all these genetically created mutants, so, yeah. And, you know, also Hipster Dave points out, you know, did we really need X-24? And they did also say, you know, it's not at all as bad as the giant silver robot, Silver Samurai, in the Wolverine. Moving on to reviews. Spoiler reviews. Yeah, some point out that it's really cliched. And, you know, there's lack of logic in enemy action sometimes. You know, you have these regular soldiers go in, not, you know, and just, yeah, going after this girl who they know have mutant powers. You know, they were working with mutants. It didn't occur to them to work out something that could, like, temporarily suppress the mutant powers or some kind of, you know, this is, I mean, it's unclear if this, which film continuity this takes place in, because it references both of the, you know, yeah, I think it references both, I believe so, but, yeah, both, you know, if it's the Apocalypse one, then, why don't they have something similar to the, you know, stun gun things that that are used in that by the military guy, Stryker. And if not that, you know, if it's the continuity that includes X3, why don't they have leech DNA? And yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and just read, you know, quote this. The supposed motivation between transcendent use of excessive numbers of soldiers just to capture Laura is not well explained, particularly if you consider what is revealed in the final third of the film. Too much focus on just one person, because, yeah, why is she so important rather than all these others? And it would not be difficult to explain. Just say that we found her and we're sure that the rest of them are nearby, so we need more troops to counter all of them. And yeah, the, you know, Richard E. Grant's character was, you know, insufficiently developed and was killed off too easily. Should have had some ace in the hole to avoid dying so easily. And let's see. One points out that it's fine that it's so structurally simple, but it's predictable in narrative events. You know, an action scene, then some dialogue, character building. And, yeah, you know, the characters, it repeats the same thing after the first retreat from the farm. In the midpoint of the film, they're chased out of the hotel they were residing in. They later, for no reason, despite being on the run, stayed at some farmhouse guys and helping the horses. It makes absolutely no sense. Get the transient troops after them with seemingly unlimited resources. And then there's a repeat again when they stop at the... He says the Eden getaway. I didn't really get the sense that that was Eden. I think that they were headed to Eden at the very end there, but I don't know. Maybe I got mixed up. I do think that that was something I thought when I saw the trailers. Logan is not just going to end up getting this family killed, is he? Just like in Origins. And yes, they were. You know, it was more emotionally resonant in this by far, but it's still just a repeat of that scene. And I get, they all, you know, right from the start, this series has been reluctant to just retcon out stuff that it messed up, you know, in a film that came before it. And let's be honest, I love the first two movies. I love Days of Future Past, but there isn't a single movie in this series that hasn't done something that was a mistake, and that later films could have tried to retcon. But, you know, I mean, in the X-Men: The Official Game retcons that the you know, Nightcrawler feels bad about not saving Jason, although, you know, some people say, oh, you know, screw that guy, why should he? He was trying to willingly commit genocide, you know, and of his own kind too. So yeah, leaving him to be crushed is not necessarily completely unreasonable. I get that, like, you know, maybe he should face trial or something, but yeah, anyway, yeah, you know, Nightcrawler actually feels bad about that, and that then explains, you know, it literally, his character says, I can't be with you X-Men, you live too violent of a life. And that fits with his characterization in the second movie and explains why he's not in the third. But then it also retcons in that, you know, oh no, the Lady Deathstrike, she survived the end of two, so yeah. But yeah, still, okay, so you're not saying that Origins didn't happen. I respect that, but you don't have to validate it and say, you know, oh, but, you know, this is just like, because that's what it is. It's a theme. Every time Logan stays with innocence, he gets them killed. You know, it's a different thing when he's hanging out with the X-Men, obviously. They can defend themselves. And let's see. I suppose that pretty well covers it. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise, the links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.